Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
I want to welcome you to worship at Highland Baptist Church. I'm Abby Calhoun. I'm the worship leader this morning, and it is a privilege to be in the house of the Lord with all of you this morning. I want to invite you as we begin worship to sing, "Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing." Would you stand and worship with us this morning, please?
Some pretty amazing people, as we have been blessed to know already. Right now, this church is a church of action, right? Not just word, but action. We're worshiping in here. Right now, there are people outside of these doors praying for you, for me, for God to work in this service right now. Right now, there's people in the nursery and toddlers and all of the other places that have people in them serving right now, because we love the Lord, and that's what we're here to do. Amen? And so, although we don't share the same story, we are all one people here with one goal in mind: to exalt the Lord Jesus Christ. Because the more that we do that, the more that we can love God better, love one another more deeply, and then go out of these doors and share the love of Christ to those who need to hear of Him. So, what I want you to do, I want to invite you to sign in and let us know you're here. If you're new to Highland, here's how you do that. On this little yellow piece of paper, there's a little tab that I would love for you to fill out and fill out the things that it's asking for there. I do promise you, I will not show up. No one from the church will show up at your door unannounced, and we will not invite ourselves into your home and give you some crazy Bible trivia quiz. That's not why we want that. We want to know, number one, how we can pray, love, and serve you better. But number two, one of the most often asked questions that new people have is, hey, how can I get connected and what's Highland all about? So with you giving us that information and dropping it into the offering plate that's going to come by in a few minutes, that gives us a way to connect you with Highland Baptist Church and for you to tell us what you need to be us praying for. So we want to help you do that, and we want to help you learn if this is a place that you want to come back to, hopefully so. And so if you are new to Highland, we want to welcome you here this morning. I think you're going to find that the people that you're sitting next to, they're real, and that God is really at work here in Highland. Amen? Amen indeed. Let me open up with or continue our worship with a brief scripture reading and then asking God to continue to pour out his presence on this place. I chose the shortest chapter in the Bible. I'm not going to do that for my sermon. I'm just doing it now. Psalm 117. The psalmist writes, "Praise the Lord, all nations. Glorify him, all peoples, for his faithful love is great to us. The Lord's faithfulness endures forever." Hallelujah. That's praise the Lord. Let's pray. Father, we come before you as the writer, the psalmist has written and would sing to you. God, we come and we ask that you would fill us this morning. God, that we would be part of that all nations, that we would praise you as our Lord this morning. God, that we would be part of all peoples this morning, that we would glorify you this morning. God, that you would show us how great and magnificent and faithful your love to us has been in your Son, Jesus Christ. May we exalt Jesus this morning. May we continue to honor you and to give glory to you because you have been so faithful to us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. We give you praise and honor this morning. And all God's people said, amen.
Would you stand as we continue worship and sing about the blood of Jesus? With the blood, we'll never lose its power. beginning tonight at 7 o'clock, the Temple Theater will be packed with men and women and teenagers, children that have set this week aside to love out loud on Meridian in Lauderdale County. In the past, you've heard that Northcrest has started that as a sister church in our association, but there are over 800 individuals signed up to help with Love Out Loud this week. That's a lot of people in Meridian loving on others. And so I am excited to be a part of that at Highland this week. There are many Sunday school classes that have taken the reins, and we will be delivering lunches to patient families in the ICU waiting areas at Rush and Anderson Hospital this week. We will have a chance to visit with those families and pray for any needs that they may have. And if it just so happens that there's nobody in the intensive care unit, which would be fabulous, we'll move our lunch somewhere else in the hospital. So we are excited about getting to love on people in the community this week. And so if you have a lunch hour, or if you have an afternoon or a whole day off this week and you haven't had a chance to get plugged in with Love Out Loud, I encourage you to pick up the phone and call me tomorrow morning. You can call the church office, you can call my cell phone, or you can see me today and say, hey, I really want to plug into that ministry, and we will find a place for you. But over the next couple of minutes, I just want to pray for all of those people, all those church members and friends that are going to participate in that ministry this week, and the lives that will be touched because of Love Out Loud. So would you pray with me, please? Father God, you are so good to us, and you have given us the opportunity to share your love with those around us. We are very fortunate and thankful, God, that you have selected and chosen us to be called your children. And while we know that that call is a great call in our lives, we also know that other people may not have ever heard of your name. And so it's my prayer that as we go as family and friends at Highland Baptist Church out into the community, God, not just this week alone, but in the days ahead, as our church has a more missional focus, God, that you will work in the hearts of us, but you will work in the hearts of those people that we will be coming in contact with. God, that you will make sure that everything that's on our lips and everything that comes out of our mouth glorifies you, so that other people can know and learn about your love. God, it's my prayer for all of the men and women and the teenagers, all of the schools that will be open this week for people to come in and paint walls, for every drive-through prayer line, for every Feed by Faith or Love's Kitchen meal that is served. God, I pray for the recipients of those meals and those prayers, God, and I pray that you will work in a way that only you can. And God, that at the end of the week, it will not be to look at what we as Highland Baptist Church have done, but it will be to look at what you have done through your people. And so I pray that lives are forever changed because of the work that is done through Meridian and Lauderdale County this week in Love Out Loud. Lord, we love you. In your Son's most precious and holy name that we pray, amen. We'll continue worship and stand, please, with Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone, as we prepare for our time of offering.
Thank you. do me a favor this morning. While I give the offertory prayer, I'd like for all of you to pray silently for Brother David, his family, and for each other. Will you pray? Almighty God, whose loving hand has given us all that we possess, grant us grace that we may honor you with our tithes and offerings, given generously and joyfully, to further your kingdom here and abroad. May we truly be faithful stewards of all your gifts. In the holy and righteous name of Jesus, we pray. Let it be so, Lord. Let it be so.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Abby and choir and instrumentalists and tech crew, always so faithful up there. You guys just do such an amazing and excellent job always of exalting Jesus so that we can exalt Jesus with you. So I appreciate your servant heart and leading us in worship. Also, before we get started, I do want to take just a minute or so and to thank our staff. We have an amazing, amazing staff. Rick, Clint, Dana, Abby, Sarah, and Marcia, and of course, Dr. Park, who served as interim for those almost 2 years. From the bottom of my heart, and I know from the church's standpoint, thank you for leading them so faithfully. Can we give them a round of applause? It makes the role as a senior pastor that much sweeter, that easier, that much more easy to come into, to just pick up where they have been leading in the first action, though, before we jump on the bandwagon to go and do, we need to sit and look up. Our first action, as we're going to be on mission with God, then is to look upward. It's what we call worship. So what is David doing? How is he getting on that page? Look with me at starting at verse 1 there. So David asked, here's David's question. It sets up the whole account here. He's asking generally now, not specifically yet, just generally. Is there anyone remaining from the family of Saul that I can show kindness to for Jonathan's sake? So David is thinking by himself, who is it that I can show kindness to for Jonathan's sake? Again, he came into a relationship, a covenant with Jonathan, his good friend. Saul, Jonathan's dad, was wanting to take David's life. Jonathan was going to save David's life. And so in return, David says, okay, I'm going to promise that I'm not going to wipe out your descendants. And so years have passed by. He's sitting by himself, or he may be talking with some of his advisors, and he thinks, who is it that I can show kindness to for Jonathan's sake? Now, there's two words that I want to draw your attention to that's going to help us focus on David seeking his enemy. Now, number one is I want you to notice the word kindness. Look at that word kindness. That is a great biblical word, but the way in which we use the word kindness in our English vernacular is not the same word that we that the Bible uses for kindness. When we think of kindness, we think of tenderness and coming alongside someone and just being very gentle with them. And there may be undertones of this, but that's not the word that is really in the Hebrew here. This word is this idea of God's loyal love. That is what theologians call his covenantal love. That when God promised Abraham that he was going to give him a people that were going to outnumber the sea, and he was going to give him a land, and he's going to make this great name for Abraham, God was faithful to that promise. No matter who went away from God, no matter who disobeyed God, no matter how much they did, God was always going to fulfill and be faithful to his promise. That's the word here. This kind of love is what we call grace. Right? It's the love that God shows to his people. It's faithful love. It's a self-initiating kind of love. This love is unmerited. This love is, the recipient is totally undeserving of it. We call it grace. The kindness, the grace that David wanted to show to Mephibosheth, according to verse 3, is not his own, but it's found in someone. He says, the kindness of God. Because David had received the kindness of God, he's now going to give the grace of God to Mephibosheth. So he's wanting to give this grace. I mean, think about David in his life. He's a shepherd out in the field among brothers who are much better and bigger and more knowledgeable and connected and known than he is. And who did God choose? Who did God go searching for? Who did God make king? Not his brothers. David. David understood the grace, totally undeserving kindness of God. And so now David has in his sights someone else, or wanting to find someone else he can show that kind of love to. David wanted to love God's way. Now, notice the second thing. Notice this question that David asked. Is there anyone? Is there anyone that I can show the kindness of God to? Who is this anyone? Well, we know him as Mephibosheth. And by the way, you young couples, if you're looking for your next name of your next boy, there you go. You got it. I'm glad we stuck with four letters. So his name, it most likely means something from the mouth of shame. In fact, his other name in 1 Chronicles is Merib-Baal, from the god Baal gods. And so this is who this guy is. He was a son of Jonathan, grandson of Saul. He's crippled in both feet. 2 Samuel 4:4 says that once he found out, or his nurse found out, his nanny found out that Saul and Jonathan had been killed in battle. Well, what's the thing that you do? Well, you pick that little boy up and you run, because the next king that's coming is probably coming for him. And so she scoops him up. She starts running. At some point, she falls. He falls out of her hands, and he's crippled in both feet. So we know he's crippled. He's also living in a place away from the purview of the king, outside of the target of the king, a place called Lodebar. We'll talk about that in a few minutes. But when Ziba told the king about Mephibosheth, what was David's response? Where is he? Where is he? Now, I want you to set this up in your mind, okay? What David's asking, is there anyone? David was not picky with his grace. He wasn't choosy with his grace in that I'm only going to look for people that look like me. David wasn't looking like that. That wasn't his focus. He wasn't looking for someone like him with the same credentials or the same expertise or similar thoughts or similar attitudes. He didn't limit his loving kindness to someone in the same social circuits or tax brackets that he was. He didn't want to just love those who are more socially connected so he can get it to the next step on the ladder. David did not care. The question was, is there anyone that I can show God's grace to? To anyone meant anyone. So the question there is, what keeps us from asking the same question? What keeps us from asking, is there anyone that I can show God's grace to? Well, in my experience, not just as a pastor, as a fellow follower of Jesus, I've noticed that when my focus and my relationship with the Lord, my worship with the Lord begins to suffer, so does my witness and mission for the Lord. But when I focus on my relationship and my worship begins to be ignited, guess what? My mission is sparked again to tell others, to show others, to be a part of what God's doing. I want to remind you of a couple things that God has told us in His Word. John 3:16 and 17. You know this, but listen to it with fresh ears again. For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him would not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through Him. God came to rescue us. And if you don't think you're an enemy of God before Jesus, listen to what Paul says in Colossians 1:21 and 22. He says, once you were alienated, that means you were at enmity with God. You were seen in Romans 5, 8 and 10. I was seen in Romans 5, 8 through 10 as an enemy of God. And Paul says, you were alienated. Once you were alienated and hostile in your minds, expressed in your evil actions. But now He has reconciled you by His physical body through His death to present you holy, faultless, and blameless before Him. What he's saying is, you were an enemy of God. You were separated from, against God. But Jesus died on the cross. And if you will put your faith in Him, then He brings you. That word reconcile is one of the great words of salvation in the Bible. It means a transfer of relationship. God sees you as an enemy at one time, and then He brings you through the death of His Son to become a friend, to become a son, to become a daughter in His family. That's what David is showing here. God calls Highland Baptist Church to seek all people, especially those far from Him. And we are to teach and reach our family members and others in our circles of influence, but also our Mephibosheths. Because at the end of the day, guys, we're Mephibosheth. We're all far from God. The vulnerable, the marginalized, those who are all but forgotten. We will be a gospel-centered and grace-motivated church when we look upward. Now, secondly, David's going to show that David brought his enemy into his house. A gospel-centered and a grace-motivated church will not share just the gospel in word only, but our very lives as well. So we need to take care, as we look upward, to begin to take care of those who are inward. All right? So look with me at verse 5. What does David do here? Verse 5 says, "So King David had him brought from the house of Machir, son of Amiel, in Lodabar." Notice that, I mean, this is elementary, but notice what is happening here. David didn't just say, "Hey, who is it that I can show, you know, kindness to that's in Saul's family left?" And that he finds out, here's Mephibosheth. Mephibosheth can't give you anything. He can't do anything. And he lives in a nowhere place. So David could have said, "Well, okay, who else is there? Because I got to give love because I really want love, right? If I'm going to do something, I want something done." But that's not what David does. What does he do? He does exactly what he says he's going to do. He didn't just talk about showing grace. He actually did it. He brought Mephibosheth from the house of Machir. Machir was this wealthy guy who lived in a place called Lodabar. And the Mephibosheth, and I've said this sort of alluding to it, but this is what he's getting at. Lodabar, lo means no, and Dabar means pasture. So you can put those two together. This guy's living off the map. I mean, he doesn't want to be anywhere near in the sights and in the target of the king. He is living a life of obscurity, hopefully below the radar, because he doesn't want to die. He has a son, so that means he probably has a wife. He doesn't want his family to be in the target of the king. So he's going to be off in this barren place, just doing his own thing, living under the radar, out of sight, out of mind, hopefully. But not out of the... He didn't go very far, did he, until David found out where he was. He brings him. Verse 6, "Mephibosheth, son of Jonathan, son of Saul, came to David, and he fell face down, paid homage." And David says, "Mephibosheth." And the response here is key. "I am your servant." Mephibosheth's fear and his humility was met with David's mercy and the king's grace. His fear and humility was met with the grace and the mercy of the king. So David says, "Don't be afraid. Since I intend to show you kindness for the sake of your father Jonathan, I will restore to you all your grandfather Saul's fields, and you will always eat meals at my table." Mephibosheth paid homage and said, "What is your servant that you take an interest in a dead dog like me?" So David is restoring everything that had been taken from him. All of Saul's fields, all of his property was being restored. David provides servants, workers to work the fields for Mephibosheth. But then that he doesn't stop there. He brings Mephibosheth into his home and to Jerusalem to live. Verse 13, we'll get there in a little bit. "And to eat at the king's table as one of the king's sons." David was generous with his grace. And Mephibosheth couldn't believe it. What does he refer to himself as? A dead dog. Now, that sounds bad in our connotation, right? But I don't think we get the gist of it. I mean, a dead dog, I guess that's a pretty bad thing to be. But in the Hebrew culture, you couldn't get any lower than a dead dog. That's about as low as you can get. And what that means is he's saying, "David, I am totally worthless. I am an absolute nobody. I am not useful to you or anyone else." Get this. He had no social status worth standing, worth anything, and he was not a contender for the throne because of his crippled feet. He had no ability to do anything because of his crippled feet. He had no access to anything because of his crippled feet and the fact that he's living in a barren wasteland. He is nothing compared to David. He lived in total seclusion and barrenness, and yet he finds mercy and grace in the presence of the king. Now, as a church, God wants Highland to be a gospel-centered, grace-motivated church. that takes care of those that are coming inward. What David did is the same thing that God wants us to do in the New Testament. 1 John 3:18, little children, let us not love in word or speech, and the implication there is only in word or speech, but in action and in truth. Now listen to what Paul says. I love this verse, and Paul, you need to underline this verse, write it down somewhere, go back and keep looking at it. This is our verse for discipleship, by the way, making disciples. 1 Thessalonians 2:8, Paul writes here, we cared for you so much that we were pleased to share with you not only the gospel of God, but also our own lives, because you had become so dear to us. See, as we look upward in worship, we also must take care of those whom God brings us. We are to share our very lives with people that God brings to us. We are not individual Christians. Okay, I want to say that. Get this, okay? Yes, God personally saves us. Yes, God personally transforms us. But he does that in the midst of his people. God has put us into a family. He redeems us and restores us with himself, but he also puts us in his family. And we don't just talk about loving God. We don't just talk about preaching the gospel, but we actually do life together. This is why small group ministry matters so much. Every Sunday, you have an opportunity to grow in gospel transformation. A couple hundred people meet for Bible study called Sunday School, right? That is a great way where gospel transformation can occur. Wednesday night, if you're a student, that is a place you need to be. That's a smaller relational environment to begin to grow in Christ, to work on growing inward like that. Children's ministry, prayer meeting on Wednesday. I know it, you get freaked out about prayer meeting. It's just talking about a bunch of lists about people that are a lot older than us and whatever. Look, we prayed Wednesday night. You need to be there. That helps transform you in the gospel. That goes on. And in fact, when the fall rolls around, we're going to go back to discipleship-focused small groups on Sunday night, because the more that we get our people into these highly relational environments, and we're focused on worship, we're focused on the gospel, we're focused on transforming, God's transforming us, can you imagine what happens to not just us, but the community when your neighborhood has a small group in it that you can then invite your neighbors to experience Jesus, to have the same transformation that you have? That's what God wants. It's upward and then inward. And then lastly, I want you to look at it's outward. David taught his friend about God's everlasting love. A gospel-centered and grace-motivated church seeks to teach the gospel in private and in public, from our homes to the public square. Let me say all that again, okay? A gospel-centered and a grace-motivated church seeks to teach the gospel in private and in public, from our homes to the public square. I want you to notice that Mephibosheth goes from being an outsider to an insider, one who was an enemy at one time, to a friend of the king. Look at the rest of the story with me. Pick up at verse 9. Then the king summoned Saul's attendant Ziba and said to him, I have given to your master's grandson all that belonged to Saul and his family. You, your sons, and your servants are to work the ground for him, and you are to bring in the crops so that your master's grandson will have food to eat. But Mephibosheth, your master's grandson, is always to eat at my table. Now Ziba had 15 sons and 20 servants, and the king, Ziba said to the king, your servant will do all that the Lord, the king, commands. So Mephibosheth ate at David's table just like one of the king's sons. And Mephibosheth had a young son whose name was Micah. All those living in Ziba's house were Mephibosheth's servants. However, pay attention to this one right here. Mephibosheth lived in Jerusalem because he always ate at the king's table. His feet had been injured. David did everything that he set out to do for Mephibosheth. He gave his family land back. He provided workers for him. He brought him into the city of David, Jerusalem, to live. But there's one phrase in here that just sticks out at me. There's two parts to it, but there's one phrase. He always ate at the king's table. His feet had been injured. That which David, or that which Mephibosheth thought would keep him from the king's table, was the very reason and what God used to display his grace and kindness as he sat at the king's table. That very thing that Mephibosheth thought would keep him from the king's table, his crippled feet, was the very display of God's grace every time he sat at that table. Look at that phrase, he always ate at the king's table. There was never a day that Mephibosheth was not welcomed at the king's table. Every day that he sat down, he was reminded of God's grace through the king. Think about that for a moment. Imagine being at the table, of what it would have been like to eat at the table of the king. Of course, you see the king come in, right? He's the king. He's got all the pomp and circumstances surrounding him, and he's in a robe, and he just, in all his regalness, he comes in, takes his place. And then following behind him, maybe Absalom, his son. He's tall, dark, handsome, right? Looks like a prince. He takes his seat. Maybe following after him is Tamar, his daughter, the king's beautiful daughter, comes strolling in, and she takes her seat. After a couple minutes, no one has started eating yet, you hear this thump. And then a clop, 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 clop. And lagging behind, just like always, is Mephibosheth. He gets to the table. He plops himself down, pulls himself up into the chair. And what you see is a big smile on his face. That's what you see. Because when Mephibosheth pulls up to the table, guess what you don't see? You don't see his crippled feet, do you? All you see is a person who has been made whole. That there's never a day that goes by that he is not invited, that he is not welcome, that he does not have a place as one of the king's sons to come and pull up to the table and remember the grace of God. Well, I think you're gonna get this analogy or this transition, but this is what this table does. Mephibosheth and the story of David, it only heightens my thoughts and my understanding of God's grace. That we were like Mephibosheth. We were living in a far and distant land, so far away from God that none of us, the Bible says, are good. None of us go seeking after God. God seeks after us, according to Romans chapter 3. We are the ones who left. We deal with sin. We want to do our own thing. But God came looking for us in Jesus Christ. Jesus died for us. He died for us on the cross so that we would have a place at the table. And when you and I come to this table, when we pull up to this table, it's not our brokenness that we remember. It's not our crippleness that we remember. It's not our spiritual disabilities that hinder us. It is the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ that we remember that has given us and invited us a place at his table. You know, this is what Paul's talking about when he writes in 1 Corinthians that he wants us to examine ourselves. It's because they weren't examining their self. They weren't remembering what Jesus has done for them and how far they were from God and how God had made them one. So when the rich would come, they wouldn't wait on the poor. They just thought they earned a spot at the table because of who they were and what spot they had in life. And so they would just start before everybody else. And Paul says, look, there, some of you are even dying because you have not understood what Jesus has done. None of us earn a spot at this table. Jesus has invited us to this table through his finished work. There's nothing that we can do to earn salvation. So Jesus, therefore, did it for us. And when he does that, he invites us to his table. So guys, we're just about to, we're going to celebrate the Lord's Supper here in a second. So if I could have my guys come forward. In just a moment, we're going to go into a time of just silent prayer and examining ourselves before the Lord. And I want you to have an opportunity to do that. This table is not Highland's table. It may be in our building, but it's not our table. This is not my table. This is not your table. This is the Lord's table. And if you are in Christ, he has invited you to his table. If you do not know, though, the Lord as your personal Savior, I want you to before you leave today, and you're going to have an opportunity to do that. But I also am going to ask, because this is a serious time. I doubt anybody's going to fall over dead in here if we take it unworthy, but I don't want to test God, right? This is a serious time because of what Jesus has done. So if you're in that spot where you just don't know if you have a personal relationship with yet, that's okay. I'm going to give you an opportunity to do that in just a few moments, but I would ask that you would refrain from taking the Lord's Supper. But if you're in Christ, this is his table. He's invited you to this so that you can remember the grace in which Jesus has given to us through his death, burial, and resurrection. So just for a few moments, let's pray silently, and then we'll move forward celebrating the supper. The Lord's Supper was instituted by Jesus as a reminder of his finished work on the cross. And it is literally the gospel, the good news of Jesus put on display for us to remember and to celebrate. The bread represents his body, which has been broken for us. The juice represents his blood that was shed for us for the remission of sin and for the sealing of the new covenant in his body and blood. And so I want to remind you as in just a few moments, the way in which we do this is you will get a cup that has both the bread and the juice in them. Make sure you take that. It's in one unit there. So when it comes by, just make sure you're getting both there. And so, gentlemen, I will serve you guys, and then if you will serve your brothers. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for another time that we get to celebrate your supper. We thank you for the time that we get to remember the gospel, the good news of Jesus, how far we were from you, but how much you did for us to bring us to yourself. So God, we ask that you would bless our time, God, as we celebrate the supper for your glory and for the good of your body here at Hylam. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
one yet.
First Corinthians 11, 23 and 24, Paul the Apostle writes, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. On the night when he," that's Jesus, "was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" In verse 25 and 26, "In the same way, also he took the cup after supper and said, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" Let's pray. Father, I can't think of a better way to not just end the sermon on Mephibosheth, but to begin the relationship with Hyland than being able to celebrate the grace that you have given to us, the grace of our salvation, the grace of our God who walks ahead of us and prepares our steps. God, we love you and we thank you that we have life everlasting in your name. We thank you that you have loved us first. And we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. In just a few moments, you're going to have an opportunity to come forward. If that would be something that you want to do during our invitation time, I will be down here in the front. Before we rush through this, I know that we're getting past 12 in just a second. I want you to hang on, okay? Because some of you, I told you I'd give you an opportunity, and I want to be, you know, I want to be a person of my word, because not just because of what I want to do, but God invites you to himself. So if you, as we've gone through this sermon, if you've seen in the text, you've seen how much God loves you, you've seen how much God has done for you in Jesus Christ, you see how far you are from him, and there's no amount of good works that will bring you back to him. You know what? The good news is Jesus doesn't care of how good your works are, because they're all dirty. We're all sinful. We all have messed up issues sometimes, or whatever it may be that you think keeps you far from the Lord. It will not. That thing that you think will keep you the furthest from the Lord will be the number one thing that God displays his grace in your life, and that you'll be able to use that to display that grace in others' life. So I want to give you an opportunity to do that. Abby's going to come and she's going to lead us in our invitation song. And if you want to know how to know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, I'll be down front here to help with that. If you want to unite and join with this church, this is a wonderful church family, and maybe God's calling you to join this church. Maybe you've seen that, you know, I'm really not following Jesus like I should be in displaying this kind of grace. Maybe you want to recommit your life today. However you need me, I'm going to be down here in the front for you. Let's all stand and continue to respond in faith this morning. you would have a seat for just a couple minutes. What a joy and a wonder, just such a joy to have people come and want for prayer and commitment. And I don't know, since we're missing Clint and Dana and all of our staff like that are gone, well, I don't know what to do now, because normally the next person would present our family for membership. Abby, you want to do it? I'm sorry. Rochelle, you're behind me and you're not in front of me. Have you joined yet? Okay. All right. I was going to say, we can do it again. I'm sure she'll bring that up at staff meeting. Sorry, I love you. thanks for my wonderful wife for telling me. So that's what you're there for, right? Help keep me straight. All right. I don't have an order. What's next? Let's all stand, grab a hand, let's sing, and then head out to serve others today.